Hey everyone, myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for Current Affairs. I welcome you all in this video where we are going to discuss a lot of interesting facts today. So let's begin today's video. But before that, if you are coming here for the first time, then do not forget to subscribe and hit the bell notification. And this is the Telegram group which you can join if you want to enjoy the free quizzes that we provide and get the latest updates instantly about the examinations. So the link of this Telegram group is in the description below. And this is the RBI Gravy 2022 course, guys, where you will get PDFs, videos and mocks along with the mock interview. So we prepare you for your final interviews as well. And this is the booklet that you will get if you enroll in this new course. And the booklet includes all the books mentioned right here in front of you. Right now, we are running a 30% discount on this course, which you can avail by using the RBI 30 coupon code. And this is the number that you can use to call us if you have any kind of query related to the examination. So that was all about the introduction. Now let's move on to the first question of the day. As per the Global Assessment Report on Drought 2021, impact of severe droughts on India's GDP can be about -% per annum despite decreasing contribution of agriculture in the country's expanding economy. So recently this report has been released by the United Nations Office for Disaster Risk Reduction. So remember, United Nations Office for Disaster Risk Reduction has released this report on the occasion of World Day to combat the desertification and drought. So we will be discussing all the details of the day as well as this report. But let's first answer this question. So out of the options, among these different ranges, the right answer is option A. So 2 to 5% GDP, basically. The droughts, the impact of drought can be so much that it can impact our GDP annually by 2 to 5%. And for a developing country like India, GDP reduction of 2% to 5% is a major issue. And therefore, this report highlights that it is the high time that India as well as the world should wake up to the call of droughts and make necessary strategies to combat the drought and its after effects. Now, let us understand this report in detail. So the very first fact here is that it was released on the World Day to combat desertification and drought, which is observed on June 17th. So remember the date, and the theme was restoration, land and recovery. So this was all about the introduction of this report. Now let us understand what this report says for the entire globe. What is the global scenario in case of droughts as per this report? So according to this report, 2/3 of the world could be living with water stress by 2025. So this is very near, guys. By the year 2025, 2/3 of the world would be living with the water stress. And as per many reports, there are approximately 30 cities in India that are at a severe risk of water crisis. So this is an alarming issue. The next point here is that the after effects of droughts can stay longer even after the end of the drought and can cause damage to agriculture and other sectors. So obviously, if there is a drought, the impact is not only on the agriculture sector, but the allied sectors as well as the manufacturing sector along with the services sectors are also impacted. Because if the primary sector is not performing well, the sectors, the manufacturing industries associated with that sector, the services sector associated with the services from the primary sector will be impacted due to the drought. The next point here is that the impact of drought. So stress on public water supply, so that would be the societal impact, the social impact of drought. Hydro energy production will be impacted, threatening human biodiversity and natural ecosystem. And through these three factors, human biodiversity and natural ecosystem, many industries would be impacted. So that is why I said that drought will not only have impact on agriculture, but it is going to impact other industries as well. Now guys, here I would like to clarify this thing that the data that I mentioned, that 30 cities in India are at the risk of water crisis, this is not mentioned in this report particularly. This data I have cited from some other report. Okay, so do not take it as part of this report. So that is something I wanted to clarify. The next point here is, globally the report has estimated the annual loss of around 6.4 billion in US due to drought, euro 9 billion in Europe, and in Australia, the study found its agricultural productivity fell by 18% during 2002-10 due to drought-like conditions. So this is highlighting how major economies are suffering because of the droughts. The next point here is that most of the world will be living with water stress in the next few years. So this is again substantiating the first point only. Now let's discuss what this report tells about India. The first point here is that the impact of severe droughts on India's GDP can be about 2 to 5% per annum despite the decreasing contribution of agriculture in the country's expanding economy. So as we are expanding, the major contribution to the GDP is done by the services sector. We all know that. And the share of agriculture is reducing year by year in the GDP. But still, if this drought comes, if the severe drought situation comes in India, then 2 to 5% of the GDP is going to be impacted due to the droughts. Therefore, this report highlights that both India as well as the entire world should wake up and do something to tackle the after effects of drought, as well as create some strategies to prevent the situation like drought to come. The next point here is that the Deccan region in India sees the highest frequency of more than 6% of severe droughts in all of India. So, if you take the example of Tamil Nadu, then Karnataka, Maharashtra, these are some of the states that we see they face drought-like situation very frequently. So, that is why the Deccan region in India sees the highest frequency of severe droughts. The study found significant drought conditions once in every 3 years in the Deccan Plateau, leading to large-scale migration and desertification. So that was a very common point. And these are the years in which severe drought-like conditions happened in India. So guys, that was all the data from this report about India as well as the world. As you can see that there are not many facts that you have to memorize because they are very general statements that have been made in this report. So here your responsibility has been reduced, but guys, do not ignore the conceptual part highlighted by this report because this is going to help you in your writing of the ESI answers if it comes in your phase 2. There you can cite the example of this report if there is a question on drought or environment related issues. So that was our first question. Now we are discussing the second question. What is India's rank in the government efficiency sub-index of IMD World Competitiveness Index 2021? So let us first discuss the answer of this question. The right answer here is 46. Now, why only this government efficiency sub-index has been asked from you? There is a special reason why I took up this parameter only. Now that I will tell you a little later. Let's first discuss this IMD's World Competitiveness Index. So this IMD stands for Institute for Management Development. The total number of countries assessed in this report are 64. And India achieved 43rd rank out of these 64 countries, which is a very remarkable rank that India has achieved. And remember that it is same since 2019. So India has been capable of maintaining its rank on 43rd position since 2019, despite the year of COVID-19 pandemic. Okay. The country which has topped is Switzerland. And Sweden is the country that has jumped from 6th rank to 2nd rank in this index. Denmark has come at the 3rd position. Now, what are the parameters of this index? The parameters are economic performance, government efficiency, business efficiency, and infrastructure. And these are the rankings of India on individual parameters. So, in economic performance, India ranked 37. In government efficiency, it is 46. Business efficiency, it is 32. Infrastructure, it is 49. Remember that all the parameters, India's rank on all these three indices or the parameters remain the same. Only this government efficiency parameter has shown some improvement. And earlier the rank was 50 in the last year's index, but this year the rank has improved to 46. That is why I took up this particular sub-index. Therefore, you should keep such things in your mind. Do not ignore these things, okay? Because such kind of information can be used in your examination to make the question more tricky. The next point here is which country has been at the bottom. So it is Venezuela. Botswana is the country that has been added to this index for the first time. So it is the new country. Parameters we have already discussed. And among the BRICS nation, India is the second after China. Russia is at the 45th. Brazil is at the 57th. And South Africa is at the 62nd position. So that was all about this World Competitiveness Index. I hope that you have understood it well. And if you have any query related to this index or related to any question that I discussed, you can ask me in the comment section or you can just ask me on the Telegram group as well. Next question is, who has been chosen as the SDG Pioneer 2021 from India by UNGC? UNGC stands for United Nations Global Compact. what is this global compact that I will be telling you, and also what does this SDG Pioneers 2021 mean, that is something that we will be discussing. So let's first know the answer of this question. So what is the right answer? The right answer is option D, Sumant Sinha, who is at present the chairman of Renew India. Now guys, first of all, let me tell you that the SDG Pioneers 2021 is the annual list that contains 10 CEOs or 10 business leaders, I would say, that contains 10 business leaders from different countries. And from India, this year, Sumant Sinha has been selected. Now, what is this list? First of all, you will understand what this list is when you understand what this UN Global Compact is. So this UN Global Compact is basically an initiative launched in the year 2000 by the United Nations Secretary General at that point of time. Now, what is the purpose of this Global Compact? If you divide this word, comp stands for companies and pact is for agreement. So this is basically a voluntary agreement or voluntary initiative of the global business leaders to drive or to achieve the SDG goals, sustainable development goals. So basically it is to mobilize the world leaders, world investors to finance or to contribute towards the achievement of sustainable development goals. That is why this agreement is important, this initiative is important, and particularly because of this reason that this UN Global Compact aims to achieve the sustainable development goals by adjuring the CEOs or business leaders, it releases this SDG Pioneers list in order to honor those people who have contributed significantly towards achieving the SDGs. And from India, Sumant Sinha has been elected in this SDGs Pioneers list. And remember, he has done a remarkable job in achieving the SDG 7, which is for affordable and clean energy. So basically, he has been honored because of his work in the field of affordable and clean energy in India, which is mentioned in the SDG 7. I hope that this much information is clear to you guys, and if you have any query, you can ask me anytime. So here comes our next question. What is the name of the portal launched by Minister of Tribal Affairs as the central repository of all training programs conducted by the tribal research institutes, different divisions of the ministry, National Society for Education and Tribal Students, Center of Excellences funded by the Ministry of Tribal Affairs and National Tribal Research Institute. So basically a portal has been launched by the Ministry of Tribal Affairs, which would act as the central repository where all the training programs conducted by these different organizations would be recorded. And what is the name of that portal? The name is option A, Adi Prashikshan is the name of this portal. Now what is the meaning of the central repository of all training programs? Basically, the structure, the content, the progress achieved through the training programs would be provided on this central repository along with a feedback portal. So there would be a space for feedback where trainees would provide their feedback so that any improvisation, if there is an improvisation needed in those programs, then the ministry can act on it by using the feedbacks of the trainees. So that is the whole purpose for launching this central repository, not only to provide the information related to the different training programs for tribal population, but also to use the feedbacks provided by the trainees to improvise those training programs. That is the whole purpose. Now remember, if the progress in the lives of tribal people is to be achieved in India, then that can only be achieved only when the tribal people are aware of their rights and entitlements, and that awareness is created by the people from these institutions because they are the representatives of the government. They are working on behalf of the government to create that awareness. And in order to create right amount of awareness, authentic awareness among the tribal population, it is very important to train these people very effectively. Therefore, these training programs need to be monitored by the ministry and their feedbacks need to be improvised. So that is all about this Adi Prashikshan. And now I am moving on to the last question. Which of the following is not a founding member of non-aligned movement countries? Indonesia, Yugoslavia, India, Egypt, Sri Lanka. Out of these, the right answer is option E. Sri Lanka is not a founding member, but Ghana. So guys, is this a static question? No. The reason behind this question being here is that recently health ministers of the NAM countries interacted with each other to discuss the measures related to COVID-19 pandemic, where Health Minister of India Harshvardhan told the countries that we are providing vaccines to almost 123 countries, which also include 59 NAM countries as well. So from there, this question pops up. What is this NAM? How many founding members are there in NAM? And when was this established? So let us discuss all about this NAM here. First of all, this NAM was created in 1961 by the founding members by these five countries. Indonesia, Yugoslavia, India, Egypt and Ghana. Guys, Yugoslavia is no more a country in itself because it has been divided into several countries. Serbia is one country that has emerged out of this Yugoslavia. So it has now become non-existent. The leaders of all these five countries held together and they created this non-aligned movement. Let me give you a brief historical background of NAM. So this NAM was created in 1961 during the period of Cold War. You would have heard about this NAM. Therefore, I'm just giving you a brief introduction about this NAM. So NAM was created in order to avoid the pressure from Russia as well as from US. Because at that time, during the Cold War, there was a pressure on all the countries to be either with US or be with Russia. So to align your policies with US, your loyalty with US, or to align your loyalty towards Russia. So it is one of the either ways, and that was the sentiment during this time period where the Indian Prime Minister of that time, Jawaharlal Nehru, came up with this idea of non-aligned movement. So remember, he was the one who moved that idea. Okay, so this was created, and the first conference of NAM was held in Belgrade, which is now in Serbia, the capital of Serbia. So it was in Belgrade where the first conference of NAM was held. And at this point of time, there are 120 member countries which are part of NAM, and 10 countries are observer countries, observer members. 10 organizations are observers of this NAM movement, non-aligned movement. Although the summits are not regular of this movement or of this alliance, I would say, but this is completely not a non-existent alliance, because the health ministers of NAM countries met recently, and there was a summit also of NAM. So remember that NAM is not a non-existent alliance right now. Now from this, my question for you emerges, and that question is, where was the last NAM summit held? You have to tell me the venue as well as the year in which the last summit of NAM held, the latest one. So that's all for today. I hope that you have enjoyed the lecture, and if you have, then do not forget to like this one. Thank you so much.